So grace to you and peace from God our Father through our Lord and our Savior Jesus the Christ. Amen. It happens all the time, doesn't it? We lose something. And it bothers the heck out of us as we search the house for it. We start throwing the cushions all over the place. We'll start tossing books out of the bookshelf. Even whether we find it or not, we end up having to clean the house because we're looking for what we need, especially when it's something we need in the moment. We continue to struggle to find it. Now, the worst one is, though, and I do this all the time, more than I'm willing to admit, it's you're looking through the house, you've been searching and searching and searching, but the whole time, it's been in my hand. I'm sure some of you have done that before, but regardless of whether you've searched up and down for minutes, for hours, for days, or even months at times, regardless if we find it, when we find it, there's a relief. There's somewhat of a joy, a peace of mind, knowing that I've found what I've been looking for. Now I can use it. If you're parents, you know how it works when a toy is lost, that you need to find that toy in order to keep peace and not so much chaotic life in the household. And so finding that thing, whatever it might be, does something. Pardon me. But one of the things that it does show us is that we do live in a sinful, fallen world. That being absent-minded, losing things, isn't necessarily a sin. It is a result of sin, however, because it sure bothers us until we find it. So that's one thing we have to acknowledge this morning, that we are lost and condemned sinners, especially apart from Christ. When you're apart from Christ, you can consider yourself dead. There is no life, for only Christ can accomplish your life, your forgiveness, your salvation. But the good news comes in our text for today. Verses 1 and 2. Now the tax collectors and sinners were all drawing near to him. And the Pharisees and the scribes grumbled, saying, "This man receives sinners and eats with them." Now, oftentimes we go through these two verses rather quickly, because it's setting up a scene for something Jesus is going to do. But there is something in these first two verses that make all theology, the entire Bible, the truth that it is. Because in these first two verses, we see that Christ is for sinners. That for tax collectors and sinners, those of whom the world thinks are below them, it's for they who Christ came. And because Christ came, he comes to give sinners life. He comes to rise them. Give them a resurrection, pardon me. But again, it is for sinners, for you, that Christ came to live, die, rise, ascend, and for whom he'll return one day. See, Christ, he's a Messiah of sinners. Because, let's face it, the righteous don't need a Savior. In fact, in our text for today, we see that this is exactly what is going on. When he finds those of whom he has lost, for again, he comes to bring to you peace and health. You see, Christ doesn't come to bring you eternal death or take you to hell. In fact, that's far from it. There will be a time in which that will happen, but that is not his main purpose. God does not want people to be lost and condemned, to go to hell, to partake of that eternal death. God wants that for no one. It's us who brings it upon ourselves. But instead, Christ, he comes to bring you to repentance. To bring you to repentance, to give you free gifts that supply you with overwhelming peace and joy in response to that repentance. You see, Christ comes to tell you, to give to you, so that you would know that God forgives you of all your sins, that God gives you his righteousness, that God gives you eternal life. And he does it without any merit or worthiness in us, because it is for sinners for whom Christ came. He has come to find the lost. He has come to raise the dead to new life. And he does it for you. But an image that we receive today is that of a shepherd and a woman. Now, the shepherd has lost one of his sheep. In fact, Jesus says, "What man of you having 100 sheep, if he has lost one of them, does not leave the 99 in the open country and go after the one that is lost until he finds it?" Now, for our Western minds, this seems rather absurd. Why would the shepherd walk away from 99 stupid sheep to search out the one? Why would he do that? Is he just leaving them behind to fend for themselves? We have to come to understand, however, how being a shepherd works, though. Because most shepherds, if not all, have those who are considered under shepherds. Those who care for those that the regular shepherd has to go. I'm sorry. It's just been one of those mornings, apparently. You know how it goes. But regardless of all of that, thanks be to God for forgiveness. But again, there are under-shepherds. Those who stay behind when the big shepherd, needs to go and take care of business, or in this case, go to find one of the lost sheep. Might think that's absurd, but there's a system. Or what woman, getting to the next parable, having 10 silver coins, if she loses one coin, does not light a lamp and sweep the house and seek diligently until she finds it? But regardless of all that we think and say, the point of this is showing that the shepherd, that the woman, they're looking for that which they need, that which they want. Because why it may not seem big to us that only one sheep is lost, to that shepherd, that could mean the difference between a hired hand or no hired hand, between eating a meal or no meal. Shepherds' lives were dependent upon their sheep. And if one died, they lost money. Or the woman, she has 10 silver coins. This is her entire life savings, or her entire wage. And so to lose a tenth of her well-being, that's a big deal. Because again, that's the difference between food and shelter, clothing, feeding a family. And so these things are really important to these people. They are part of their way of life. See, this is how God acts with you, with those who are lost. You see, he seeks them out to bring them back to the fold, to make them his. He has created them to be his treasure, his people. You see, when he finds you, when he brings you to repentance, which is a gift, when he brings you to repentance, there is more joy in heaven over one person who repents than over 99 people who don't need to repent. The righteous have no need to repent. They don't need a Savior. But it's for the one, for the small, for the unlikely, for the sinner that he has come to find, to bring them to himself. In fact, Jesus says it. "Just so I tell you, there will be more joy in heaven over one sinner who repents than over 99 righteous persons who need no repentance." Now, it does seem to be absurd that somebody would rejoice over such an insignificant thing in the long run. But just as a shepherd calls his family, his friends, his neighbors together to rejoice over the one sheep that has been found, that was lost but is now found, or the woman, when she finds her coin, she calls her friends and family, her neighbors, to rejoice with them. For they have found what they have lost. If there is such joy with so insignificant things with people like these, and that there is more joy over one than the 99, how much joy is there in heaven when all of us have repented? When all of us have turned away from our sin, from death and the devil, from the things that we love that really aren't good for us. There is such joy in heaven. There is feasting. In fact, one of the things to point out is somewhat of an ironic thing that the shepherd calls people together essentially to have a feast, which means he's going to sacrifice one of the lambs that he left behind. But that goes beyond the story, because the story focuses around the one, the single, the small. And so God focuses on you. He focuses on you and wants to give you things, wants you to bring him to himself. He wants you to repent. Now you might be asking yourself, what really is repentance though? We hear that word all the time, don't we? But what does it mean? Well, in the Greek and the Hebrew, the word really means to make a 180-degree turn away from something. In the case of theology and our sinfulness, it is there to turn us away from our sin, from death, from the devil, the things that we love of the flesh, and to turn us to himself, to God, to focus on Christ and the gifts that he gives. Where he forgives you all your sins, where he declares you righteous after giving you his righteousness. You see, what repentance does is it changes one's mind. And if it changes our mind towards the things that really matter, to the holy things of God, our life is going to look different. We're going to live repentant lives. We're no longer going to live in that sin. And the good thing is that God is the one who does it even for us. It may not seem like it doesn't register with our minds, but God does it because he loves you and he wants you to live with peace and joy. For a lot of things have been accomplished by God through Christ's merits and sacrifice. And he continues to give it to you. Peace and joy, forgiveness, life. He gives it to you now through his word and his sacraments. You see, God does stuff. And when stuff happens, something happens. It's absolute. There's no turning back. And so when God turns you away through the law and the gospel, what he's trying to do is to turn you away from the guilt, the shame, the bad conscience that seems to plague you, where things are weighing us down. What God really wants for you is peace, to live with a good conscience. In fact, one of the sacraments he gives to us, holy baptism, it now saves you. Not as a removal of dirt from the body, but as an appeal to God for a good conscience through the resurrection of Jesus Christ, who has gone into heaven and is at the right hand of God, with angels, authorities, and powers having been subjected to him. See, you can remember your baptism. And when you remember your baptism, you can remember what Christ has done for you and continues to do for you. That he has set you free. That he has released you from the bondage of sin, death, and devil. That he has released you from yourself. And that you can live a life with peace and joy that is even now sometimes beyond our comprehension. That's God for you. And one of the things that we do is practicing repentance. And it's not anything all that really complicated. In fact, we did it just a moment ago, where we confessed our sin. We acknowledge that we are by nature sinful and unclean. That we have sinned in thought, word, and deed. When we acknowledge that, God doesn't stay silent about it. Instead, he sends you word, the word through your pastor, that in his stead, as if Jesus is there talking to you, to you himself, as if he is there saying that I forgive you all your sins. Yes, in the stead and by the command of your Lord Jesus Christ, your pastor is there to forgive you your sins. That's his job description. He's there to release you from the bondage of your conscience. That's why confession and absolution can even be done privately. It's not just something that's Roman Catholic. But for us, it's private confession and absolution, where you can get rid of what's bothering you, to place it on Christ. Because he, Pastor Emily and I, we've taken what we call the confessional seal, where anything that is said to us is there as if God is taking it away. It stays there. In fact, it actually doesn't even stay there. It goes to Christ on the cross, where you see that thing that is weighing you down, that sin. It's been conquered by Christ. It's been conquered by him, and so now he wants you to live a life boldly. Sins forgiven. So that brings us to the good news, that out of God's grace, his undeserved love, he gives you forgiveness, life, and salvation. Not with any merit or worthiness in us, because we are lost, condemned, but out of fatherly divine goodness and mercy. And he wants to give it to you for free. He's paid for it. And so he wants to give it to you. And so all you need is to receive it, to be given it by Christ. That's the good news for us as Christians. We don't even have to work for it. Christ did all the work for us. And through his work, through his sacrifice, through his death, he forgives you. He takes your sin away and places it upon himself on the cross. And even better news is that he doesn't stay dead, but he rises, giving you new life to live now and into eternity. Your eternal life started at your baptism. That's why we receive baptism. It's not just this ceremony, but it's actually giving of God's gifts to the one he has chosen to be his child. And so he's chosen you to be his children, to be his heirs, and that he will give you the kingdom that is beyond our comprehension now, but starts here with through the forgiveness of your sins. So hold on to it, grasp it, for it is there for you. God keeps his promises. And if you want proof of that, look to the cross. Look to the empty tomb. Look to his ascension. Look to the time that he will return for you, not to take you to hell, but to hold you fast to himself so that you and he can enjoy eternal life together in heaven, where there is no longer pain, no longer any suffering, no longer any sin, but pure goodness and joy and peace. It is yours. Now live with it. Amen.